Trudge the Road on BCTV.
Underwritten by the Care and Treatment Centers.
If drugs or alcohol are an issue in your life,
or the life of someone you love,
we're here to offer insight into the disease of addiction.
Trudge the Road.
Welcome to Trudge the Road. We're your hosts. I'm Rich, a recovered drug addict.
My name is Jerry, and I'm a sober alcoholic.
Well, how you doing, Jerry?
I'm well. How y'all?
Pretty good. We've got a great show for you today. We're going to be talking about guilt, forgiveness. We're going to talk about the Hand of AA, which is a conference that's going to be happening in March that Jerry and I are both going to be at. But before we get started here today, Jerry, if you would, please let everyone know why we do this show.
Absolutely. Trudge the Road is a television program dedicated to folks like ourselves who suffer from the disease of addiction to drugs and alcohol. And every bit is important. Family members and friends, you suffer tremendously, and we know that you've got a lot of questions. Our goal here is to answer as many of those questions as we possibly can, and with the grace of a power greater than ourselves, hopefully find some kind of a solution to this incredible dilemma, which is the disease of addiction.
A couple of programming notes we'd like to share with you. Our website is trudgetheroadradio.com. Just go ahead and simply write that down, trudgetheroadradio.com. There you can hook up with our Facebook, also our Twitter. You can catch all prior episodes because Trudge the Road Radio is a radio show. Mm-hmm. And it's heard all over the country. And we also shoot it out to various social media sites as well. But if you'd like to just save yourself the time, just go to trudgetheroadradio.com. As I mentioned, we'll talk about the Hand of AA coming up in just a few minutes. But the topic today is forgiveness. And I won't sing the song. We were talking about what we were going to talk about today, and we said forgiveness. Mm-hmm. And apparently there's a Don Henley song where, forgiveness.
We know the song. I've heard it over and over all afternoon.
It's an earworm that kind of gets in your head. But forgiveness, it's a big part of recovery.
And it's a tricky part. It's difficult. Because I remember vividly, you know, early in recovery saying, you know, because of issues that I had felt that people had done to me that had caused me harm, to forgive them. Well, you know, how do you forgive people? I mean, what is that? What's the process? Are there steps to that? You know, and I'll give you the example, which I think is the best. If I borrowed $500 from you, mm-hmm. With the intention of paying it back when I get paid on the first, you'd probably do it. You've known me for 20 years. You know I'm good for it, and I am. I would pay that $500 back. But let's say by some terrible misfortune, I lost my job, and all of a sudden my funds had just stopped. And you knew this, and you know, felt for me and the situation I was in, and said, "Hey, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. The debt is forgiven." Now, that doesn't mean the action didn't occur. The action most certainly did. I did borrow the $500. That did happen. And I was going to pay it back. That did not happen. And you, out of the goodness of your heart, forgave the debt. And the difference is here in forgiveness is that there's no contempt. And that's the big word. And I think that that's the big thing we focus on a lot is contempt. Within forgiveness, and there is a lot of forgiveness both ways for all addicts, for the incredible harm that we caused and that the amends that we have to make for that, and hopefully the forgiveness that we'll give. It's kind of like ethics. You know, ethics is natural morality. I know good, I know evil, I know bad, I know good, I know that consciousness, you know. For some reason, you know, we could go for, well, actually not for some, for so many reasons, why the level of our morality changes as the degree of our addiction continues, in the rationalization process, and then the guilt and the shame. And for us, that guilt and shame becomes what we like to call the fabric of our soul. And the only way to deal with it is more drugs and alcohol. Again, you know, from the beginning, that's what separates, you know, an alcoholic from a non-alcoholic. They don't drink for reasons of guilt and shame. And ours are overwhelming. Forgiveness, forgiving people for what they have done to me has sometimes been a bit of a process because of resentment. And that's our number one offender, is resentment. I'm reliving that anger over and over again. And forgiveness is really the ticket. And what I learned, you know, a lot about people who had the ability to forgive was an incident that occurred within our own culture here. The Nickel Mines shooting, which is not really far from the Berks County area, and you may recall it's where the Amish children were viciously murdered. Five of them died, and five of them were horrifically
injured.
That was
10 years ago, just this past week or so, wasn't it?
It was in October.
I'm sorry, October. Right. But
October.
This year is 10 years.
10 years. Where does 10 years go? Mm. And the response of the first response of the Amish people was forgiveness. Their very first response, which in all honesty would not have been mine. You know, mine would have been anger and resentment and possibly revenge or give me a reason or whatever. They met the entire issue with forgiveness and embraced the family of the person who had committed this atrocity. And I found that amazing and asked, I was on a TLC special and had the opportunity to be with the Amish people who had experienced that and learned a little bit about their method of forgiveness, that it's just not a blanket thing. You know, well, you are forgiven, and from that word is he forgive and forget. You know, that really doesn't occur. And what these people were doing in the process of their forgiving was to be a daily basis, to wake up again in that morning and relive for a moment that horror and that anger and go through that process again of forgiving this person for today. And really that is where we tie in our recovery, one day at a time. And as he explained to me, each day it was a little bit easier to make that forgiveness, to find that very special place in your soul to forgive, you know. And so again, that's a process. For drug addicts and alcoholics, and really what it comes down to is just narcissism in reverse. I know you probably want to take a break, but that's what it is, and I'm sure that you've said it. I'm just too bad. I'm too bad. I can't be forgiven for the things that I have done.
Yeah. Well, we talk about it a lot. I mean, one of the biggest things that an addict or an alcoholic wants to do is to go back in time and change the past.
That's it.
You can't do it.
And you hit the nail on the head. It's the big wish. The biggest wish that every drug addict and alcoholic has is not to hit the lottery. You'd think it might be, but it's not. Our biggest wish is that we have the ability to go back and change the past. Because if I could change everything that had occurred, none of this would be happening right now. In those feelings, that remorse, that guilt, that shame, those overwhelming emotions that will actually control and demand a quality of my life that is very demeaning to where it should be,
right.
which is the disease itself, occurs on a regular basis until, you know, I can alleviate the fact that, you know. And one thing that I've learned is that, you know, amongst alcoholics and drug addicts, it's bad, but you're not that good at being bad. I mean, there are reasons. There is definitely accountability, but there's also an explanation. There is a reason, you know, why we do this. The phenomenon of craving, which I'll explain when we come back.
We're going to talk about the phenomenon of craving. We're also going to talk about the hand of AA coming up and some of the guilt that's associated. It's funny that you brought up the Nickel Mines incident only because the mother of the shooter of that particular incident, which happened 10 years ago this October, wrote an article that's in Women's Day magazine, just came out last week. And it is an entire article that talks about the forgiveness that the Amish community gave them immediately beginning. Mm-hmm. And you hit the nail on the head when you were talking about it and how they came over and how losing a child is such a terrible thing, but how they did not blame the family.
Right.
So we'll talk about that and a bunch of other stuff. This is Trudge the Road on Trudge the Road Radio on BCTV.
You're watching Trudge the Road on BCTV, underwritten by the Karen Treatment Centers.
You can find more information and insight at trudgetheroadradio.com.
And you can find archived episodes of this show and past shows at bctv.org. Just search Trudge the Road in On Demand.
Trudge the Road.
Hi, welcome back. Wow, it was quick. I'm Rich, a recovered drug addict.
My name is Jerry. I'm a sober alcoholic.
And we are the hosts of Trudge the Road. Trudge the Road here on bctv.org. And by the way, BCTV now has a YouTube channel.
Yes, they do.
So go to bctv.org and you can catch all the prior episodes that we've done over the last year on the YouTube channel. We're talking about forgiveness and we're talking about guilt, and we somehow meandered over to the phenomenon of craving, which I think you have a fantastic explanation for.
Well, it is. It's part of the disease. I mean, there is some explanation for our behavior, and I'm certainly not trying to in any way demean accountability. We are accountable for our behavior, but there is a level of responsibility that definitely has explanation, and that is what we suffer from, which is called the phenomenon of craving. Now, a drug addict or alcoholic absolutely positively understands and knows what that feeling is, the feeling that I absolutely positively have to have it. How I'm going to explain it to you folks who do not suffer from the disease of addiction is the fact of the matter is that you're craving something right now and you don't even know it. What are you craving? Air. Now, if I had a plastic bag from Walmart and I slipped it over Rich's head here and held it, well, he'd realize that craving real quick.
I'd fight him.
Well,
I'd
not yet. Your brain would do. Your brain would right away say, do something. We're in trouble.
Right.
But I just continue to hold that bag there. And now your brain says, do something or we're going to die. That's when you'll fight me to get that off your head. Ladies and gentlemen, there's no gray area here. This is a black and white fact. That is exactly what our brains are doing the addicted person when we are craving. It's not saying let's go out and have a good time with the gang or let's all get together and smile and have fun at the beach. It says you get this stuff or we die. Get it or we die. That's why you stole your grandmother's jewelry to get it. It was a crime of survival. So am I accountable for that behavior? You better believe I'm accountable. Am I responsible? No, I'm not. I just proved that. That's part of the pathology of the disease. And again, this is not a theory. That's exactly what's happened and why we go to these extremes and do such acts that have such devastating consequences is to answer this. Fortunately, for people like ourselves who absolutely know what that phenomenon is, due to the miracle of recovery and the love of the people within the recovering community, we don't have to do drugs or alcohol again. And the thing about the phenomenon of craving, it cannot occur. It cannot occur unless I put drugs and alcohol in my system. Now, I might mentally obsess for it, but that craving factor, that can't happen unless I drink or drug again. And if I drink or drug again, frankly, it's a matter of time, mm-hmm. you know, before it happens.
Right. Now, I want to go back, if we could. We were talking about forgiveness, and I thought you laid it out very nicely about the $500 and how we forgive somebody. But I think one of the big things in the process, too, and it's something that we had a conversation about this week, is forgiving yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I, without getting too specific, I have someone in my life that continues to pound me, even though I've been sober 15 years, continues to tell me what a terrible person I was,
mm-hmm.
You know, over and over. Here we are 15 years later, and I'm still hearing it and still being faced with that. But there reached a certain point in my life where I had to, you know, all the apologies and the I'm sorries and then I was wrongs didn't seem to move the needle with that particular person. And unfortunately, I can't avoid that person. Mm-hmm. So there came a point where I had to forgive myself so that I could move on and continue living. I can't beat myself up for the rest of my life. No. I can't say, you know, I've said it. I was wrong. My behavior was a horrible and, you know, pitiful, incomprehensible demoralization is where I was at. But somewhere along the line, I had to forgive myself. And it wasn't an easy process. But it did happen, and I do move forward to this day. So when that topic is brought up, which it is about once a year, able to move.
But it does bring up an important factor, guilt, you know. And where would we be without guilt? Guilt's really important. It's what motivates me to sorrow. And I think that when we are seeking forgiveness, and I do seek forgiveness, I have to be sorry for it. And what is my level of sorrow? How bad do I feel about this that I'm willing to face that embarrassment, however degrading it may be, to be able to try to confront this so that I feel better is a very selfish thing. But I do seek forgiveness. We all seek forgiveness. It's of human nature. And I'll give you an example, is that my ex-father-in-law, I owed money to, and it had been years, a decade, and I paid him back the money, and I was giving him the money, and he said to me clearly, he says, I don't want the money, I don't care about the money. He says, I just want you to stay sober and to be a good father to that child. The money is irrelevant. And what I explained to him, it's not important. The important thing is that I give you this money, that I do the right thing, because what I am is I am asking you to forgive me for this behavior, and this act is very important for me to be able to do that. And he did accept the money on those terms. And that really is important, because there are going to be times in the amends process where you're not going to be forgiven, and that's okay. I'm not there to be forgiven. It's wonderful to ask for forgiveness, to get forgiveness, but it's my responsibility to make amends, to be honest and say that I was wrong, and to say this time I am sorry. And even you have to realize, when you do say I'm sorry, you're not saying I'll never do this again. Yeah, I'm sorry I did this. And that was always the case with us. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Always followed by with, it happens again. The amends process in the ninth step recognizes the fact that my behavior was at minimum inappropriate and it was wrong, and I need to make amends for that, and then move on and ask, tell them I'm sorry, ask for the forgiveness. If I get it, I'm blessed, you know. But it comes again, that two-way street. To get it, I got to give it.
Well, you know? I've given it. Yeah. I, you know, but I'm not getting it, and I had to reach a point where I had to move past it, you know, because I was never going to get it.
It's your part of the street.
It is clean.
Exactly. And that's not a huge issue. I mean, you're talking about an ex-spouse, and I think a lot of people, you know, that resentment
can go on. I did not say
that. I think they figured it out.
Do you think they figured it out?
I think so. And that behavior, you know, is not uncommon, but it's just such a waste of time, you know, because again, it's resentment. Every time I see you, I relive a feeling of behavior that took place 15 years ago. That person does not exist anymore. That person has found the humility to be able to admit that they were wrong, and seek that at least a level of communication between the two of us opens up is a very healthy approach in the beginning of repairing a relationship. But as you said, it does take two, you know. And then there are those unbelievable, horrible things that happen that are incomprehensible. And it's just my opinion that, you know, that those things are only things that God can really forgive, you know, that are just too huge.
Well, just for the record, I did not say an ex-spouse. I did not say an ex-spouse. He said it. Either way, we've got the Hand of AA coming up later next month, and we're going to talk about it because Trudge the Road is going to be there. For Jerry, I'm Rich. We'll be right back. This is Trudge the Road on BCTV.
You're watching Trudge the Road on BCTV.
Underwritten by the Care and Treatment Centers.
More information and insight can be found at TrudgeTheRoadRadio.com.
Hi, and welcome back to Trudge the Road here on BCTV. Just right out of the gate, I didn't say it. This guy over here said it. Hey, TrudgeTheRoadRadio.com is our website. We encourage you to go there. You can catch prior episodes of the radio show. And we are posting some BCTV stuff up there, but BCTV has its own YouTube channel now. So you can go there and watch these shows, this show, and prior episodes as well. But on TrudgeTheRoadRadio.com, that's where you can find our Facebook, you can find our Twitter, you can find news about what we're doing and places we're going to be. But right now, I want to throw this out there because it's kind of a big deal for us to be a part of the Hand of AA in Lancaster, which is coming up in March.
Exactly. It's at the sixth conference. They do a wonderful job. And the folks here in Berks County, it's just a trip down the road. It won't take any time at all to get to the Host Resort, which is on 30. If you know where Dutch Wonderland is, you probably know where that is as a landmark. It's just down the street from there. Beautiful resort. And this conference is going to be absolutely magnificent. Each year, it has gotten better and better and better. And they're bringing in some absolutely wonderful speakers from outside of our culture, which is always interesting. It's always funny. It's always entertaining. There's a lot of fellowship. There's certainly a couple of speaker panels. There are AA meetings that are held. There's lots of food. There's a big banquet and things of that nature. But what kind of separates this particular conference from others is the fact that the committee goes out of their way to go to every treatment center really around the area. And in the Philadelphia area, there's a lot of treatment centers.
Right.
And via contributions from members of the recovering community, we bring these people who are actually still in treatment, most of them probably in their last week, and bring them right into this conference so that they can not just taste what Alcoholics Anonymous is, but to go to an event. Mm-hmm. And there truly is an event. And I know I speak for you because we've been to so many conferences that there's just something magic about an Alcoholics Anonymous conference. And it's a spiritual thing, I believe. But this one will be one that will be certainly one of the same that everybody will thoroughly enjoy. It's a real bargain. It's $20, unless you want to have the buffet. Then it's $30, and that's real cheap. And as I said, the speakers are absolutely outstanding. We're going to record them, and we'll have some opportunities for folks to pick up on some of our stuff too.
Well, it's that you say that. You said yeah, some great speakers are going to be there, but we're going to be there too. And I'm very excited about it because we are actually going to be running the table with the speaker tapes, and we're also going to have a special table where Jerry is going to be set up at. Jerry's going to be set up with his DVD, which is called Jerry and the 12 Steps. And we're going to get you set up like a book signing. You know, where you're going to sit back there, you're going to have your jacket, there'll be a little picture of him there, and then they'll be all stacked all neatly, and he'll be sitting there with his Sharpie. Come on down and get one of these Jerry and the 12 Steps DVDs. They're fantastic DVDs, which, by the way, if you're unable to make it to the Hand of AA, you can also get one via our website, which is TrudgeTheRoadRadio.com. Amazon is another place you can pick it up.
Absolutely. And, you know, it really is a good tool. The 12 steps of recovery, which we believe is our blueprint for living, giving us the opportunity to live a life happy, joyous, free, honest, humble, things of that nature. But it can be a little bit difficult to comprehend, especially in that early recovery. And that's what this DVD is meant to do, is explain each step simply so that we can start the thinking process and be able to for you to begin a journey of absolute epic proportion. And that's recovery within the 12 steps of AA and NA.
Yeah, it's a fantastic gift as well. Plus, it's being used clinically at treatment centers all around this country. As a matter of fact, I know we just sent a shipment of 40 of them out
to the Bradford Group,
which is runs down into the South. They're in Tennessee, and they're in Alabama, and a couple of different treatment centers.
Mississippi, Florida, Deep South.
Absolutely. So, and not only that, but Karen Treatment Centers here in Berks County is kind of where it all got started, up mm-hmm. there at Karen, and David Rotenberg and Mike Early and all those
Doug
guys.
Doug Thiemann.
Yeah, fantastic for believing in us from the very beginning. And of course, believing in Jerry as well, so we could get that DVD out there. So again, it's only 23 minutes long. It's not going to take up your whole afternoon, and it's definitely going to plant some seeds, and it's a fantastic recovery tool. So he will have that out at the Hand of AA, and like I say, Sharpie in hand and ready. See, the thing is that when we're out there, we try to sell these DVDs he gives them away. He is the worst business guy when it comes to this stuff. So come on out, because we'd love to meet you. It's Hannah Bay, and it's coming up in March.
And it's the beautiful people of Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and beautiful Lancaster. We would love to see and hope to see you there.
Absolutely. Our website, trudgetheroadradio.com. For Jerry, I'm Rich. We're Trudge the Road on BCTV.
Trudge the Road on BCTV is underwritten by the Karen Treatment Centers. For more information, find us at trudgetheroadradio.com. Until next month,
we shall be with you in the fellowship of the Spirit.
And you will surely meet some of us as you trudge the road of happy destiny.
Trudge the Road.